We're in lesson 8 on page 183. We started into lesson 8 last time, and so we're going to do just a brief review and jump back in. But we've got a new memory verse here with lesson 8. It is 2 Corinthians 5:17. So we'll do as we have. We'll do the reference, and then the verse, and then the reference. Are you ready? 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. 2 Corinthians 5:17. This lesson 8 is part of a new section. If you see in your books on the page, it would be 179. Doesn't have a page. It's the external expression of living the exchange. So in the first few lessons we looked at in chapters 1 through 3, we talked about the foundations of living the truth that gives victory to us in our Christian lives. That was chapters 1 through 3. So that was kind of where we talked about the car. And then we looked at chapters 4 through 7 was the internal dynamics. That was where we lifted the hood on the car and looked at what makes it go. And so now we come to chapter 8, and chapter 8 through 12 will be the grace of the gospel in action. We could say, what does this life of grace look like in everyday living? What does it look like, practically speaking? And that's what we need, is just the intensely practical, well, what do I do on Monday? Because, as I've said many times before, it's real easy to be spiritual on Sunday, isn't it? When you're here and you're surrounded by other believers who want to do right, it's real easy to be spiritual. But when you go home and you wake up on the wrong side of the bed on Monday, and you get two different socks, and you've got a sniffle, and then the boss calls and says you're 3 hours late, and all of these things, so how does it look practically when you get right down to it? And we come here to day one. Page 184, where we're embracing internal change. As I mentioned last week, we don't like change, do we? Nobody likes change. We want to remain the same because where we are is where we're most comfortable. But all of us need to be changed. According to Scripture, we need to be changed more into the image of Jesus Christ. And what takes place between justification and glorification is sanctification, the process where we are made more into the image of Jesus. And so we break down Ephesians 2:8 and 8 through 10. We know 8 and 9 real well. Those are the verses that we quote a lot when we're giving the gospel to somebody, and we need them to understand, hey, this isn't anything that you do. This is something that God has done. Ephesians 2:8 says, "For by grace are ye saved through faith. That not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." And that's where we usually stop in our gospel presentation, because the point has been made, right? To a lost person, this is all about God and what he has done. It's not about your works. It's not about anything that you add on. It's about what God has done. But then verse 10 is where we pick up. So if verses 8 and 9 deal with justification, then verse 10 deals with sanctification, where it says, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them." Now, last week, and I'm not going to go through all of this, I'm going to go through it quickly, but last week I put a few verses up before you and asked you, how is a Christian supposed to walk according to these verses? I started with Ephesians 4:1, which tells us that we're supposed to walk worthy of the vocation wherewith we're called. Ephesians 4:17 tells us that we're supposed to walk not as other Gentiles walk, according to who walk in the vanity of their mind. They walk in emptiness. We're supposed to walk worthy of the vocation wherewith we're called. We're supposed to walk differently than the world. There should be a marked difference between a believer and a lost person. That is fact from Scripture, okay? And we should walk with purpose. Ephesians 5:2 tells us that we should walk in love. Love for one another within the body of Christ. Love for who else? Love for others who are outside of the body of Christ. And love, of course, that motivates all things. Love for God. Ephesians 5:8, you'll note all of these are from Ephesians. Ephesians 5:8 says that we are to walk as children of light. the light that we get from God's Word. And then Ephesians 5:15, that we are to walk circumspectly. We need to be mindful. The world is like a minefield. We need to be careful because we have an adversary, the devil, who walks about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. I mentioned walking circumspectly. Think walking through a cow pasture in church shoes. Okay? That's walking circumspectly. You say, I don't want to step here. I do want to step here. That's how it is in the Christian life, because there's all sorts of nonsense that's coming down the pike at us all the time. And you have to be discerning, which is walking circumspectly. You say, okay, I'm going to engage in this because this meets the test of God's Word. I'm not going to engage in this because this fails the test of God's Word. We're walking circumspectly. Walking has the idea of one step, right?
Many one steps, right?
I'm going to make the right choice. And then I'm going to make the right choice. And we keep taking right steps. Wouldn't it be great if the Christian life, you could say, I'm just going to serve God. And that's the step you have to make, and then it's just gravy after that. Then it just works. That's not how it works. I'm going to serve the Lord right now. And then the next temptation comes, and what do you have to decide? Well, I'm going to serve the Lord right now, and right now. And it's just more and more repeated steps. The Christian life in Ephesians 4:22 also compared to taking off and putting on a garment. That you put off concerning the former conversation or lifestyle, the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lusts. So, the question number four, and this is all review, that's why I'm going so fast. Question number four on page 185, what happened to your old man according to Romans 6:6?
Crucified.
Crucified is a method of killing something, okay? You don't come down off the cross alive. The old man is crucified with him. It says in Romans 6:6, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. You don't have to sin. You don't have to sin this afternoon. You don't have to sin tomorrow. We have a choice that is given to us by our birthright as believers. When we trust the Lord Jesus Christ and we're indwelt by the Spirit of God, we no longer have to sin. Okay? We're not bound to that old nature. On page 185, we read, your unregenerate spirit could never please God and is now dead. However, the residual influence of that old nature still remains in your lifestyle. We talk about indwelling sin. We sing the song, prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. I don't have to sin, but I still have that bent towards it that we all experience. Back on page 185, you form patterns of behavior that your flesh is loath to give up. When you got saved, God rewired you, so to speak. As a result of the exchange you made with Jesus, you're connected to God's vast spiritual resources, and his enabling grace flows through you as you trust and obey. We have the power, the resurrection power of Christ is at our disposal. We don't have to sin. We can choose to do right. We can choose to do right. The trouble is, we often don't. We make a conscious choice. Maybe it's because it's an old habit. And they say old habits die hard. And we can all attest to that. Old habits die hard. I come into a situation, well, this is what I used to do. Well, you don't have to do that anymore. You can walk in victory. You can say no to the flesh. You can put off the old man, put on the new man, and you can do what's right. And again, this sounds real simple, right? This is just, it's almost insultingly simple, right? So why do we miss it so much? Why do we do wrong? Well, because we like to. The reason you do wrong, the reason I do wrong, is because there's pleasure in sin for a season. It's real short. Let's come here to new material, page 188, day two. We'll start off with a quote from page 188. He says, everyone has a functional source. It's what we depend on for provision, stability, and control in our lives. Now, what do you think the Bible would have us to have as our functional source?
Jesus.
Jesus. Specifically, the Spirit of God living inside, right? That should be our functional source. How can we determine our functional source? Well, he gives a little math problem. I'm not good with math, but I understand this. Time plus stress equals your functional source. Now, that's uncomfortable. Because a lot of times we kind of give ourselves a pass. Have you ever heard or maybe said, well, I was just stressed. Well, what comes out when you're stressed is what you put in. That reveals to you your functional source. I've used the illustration, if I put an orange up here in front of you and I squeeze it just right, I can't get grapefruit juice out of it. Why? Because it's an orange. Why? If I am full of the Spirit of God, if I'm walking in the Spirit and I get under stress and the right time comes, what's going to come out? The Spirit of God. If that's what is in, if that's the steps of obedience that I'm taking, it will reveal that my functional source is in fact what it should be, the Spirit of God. And I will respond to stress just like Jesus did. But the trouble is that many times time and stress reveal that my functional source is my flesh. And I attempt to live the Christian life in the power of the flesh, and that doesn't work. We've all tried it, and we can all attest to the fact it doesn't work. So, question number one on page 188. What does God call the choice to draw from your own resources instead of His? Jeremiah 2, verse 13 says, "For my people have committed two evils. They've forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and hewed them out cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water." So, What does God call it when I try to live in the power of Ben Linville?
Self.
And what would you say of a cistern that is broken and can hold no water?
Useless.
What's the point of a cistern, right? If it doesn't, if I've got a bucket that doesn't have a bottom in it, what do I have? A piece of junk, right? Well, this bucket serves no purpose. And a believer who's walking in the power of the flesh and attempting to live victoriously through grit and determination or self-discipline or gumption or whatever you want to call it is missing the boat until they realize the power that God has placed at our disposal. And this is not some new age mystical, well, you know, tap into your inner goodness. No, this is who lives inside of you. This is Galatians 2:20, where it says, "I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. The life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me, gave himself for me." That's what it's all about. What would you consider to be your primary functional source prior to salvation? Before you were born again, where'd you get your power to do whatever it is you did?
Breakfast in the morning.
Yeah. Breakfast in the morning. Yeah. Wheaties. What is the functional source of a lost person?
Self.
It can't be Christ. It can't be God. It's, again, because we started out talking about God's not the force. You don't tap into the force and, well, I'm a lost person, but I can tap into God and accomplish what? No. You either have Christ because you've been born again into the family of God, indwelt by the Spirit of God, and enabled to live victoriously, or you are lost and undone and completely without Christ. And with, according to Scripture, without hope in the world. The flesh was our primary source. Sometimes self-reformed. Have you ever met a nice lost person?
Oh, yeah.
Lots of them, right? It's not impossible to have a lost, nice person, right? But their niceness doesn't overcome, it doesn't compensate for the fact that they are, in fact, lost. According to Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 24, what are we to put on? What is the functional source that we should have is, it says, "And that ye put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness." Take a look on page 188, and I'll read you a quote that he has there. It says, "Before receiving Christ, your old man or your unregenerate spirit had complete sway over your soul. And the reason for that is because that's all there was. That was all there was. Before you trusted Christ, all you had was the old man. You were alive to sin, but dead to Christ. Your new man, or your regenerated spirit, was born in you at the moment of salvation. Justification is the word we've been using. Until then, your only source was your old man. And as a result, you couldn't do anything that pleased God. Let me say that last phrase again. You couldn't do anything that pleased God. Okay? Proof of that, we find in Proverbs chapter 21, verse 4. We read, it says, the plowing of the wicked is sin. Maybe you're more familiar with Isaiah 64, 6. But we are all as an unclean thing, and all our righteousnesses are as
filthy rags.
Do filthy rags please God?
No.
Filthy rags don't even please you. They don't please me. Take a look at Ephesians 4:24. Okay, so if you have your Bibles, open up to Ephesians 4:24. I'll also put it here on the screen, and in a moment I'm going to have you turn to another passage. So get your Bibles out and get those ready. Look at Ephesians 4:24 while I read a quote from page 188. Okay, so I want you to look at the verse, and you'll see the truth. You'll see the connection. It says on page 188, you're looking at Ephesians 4:24. Your new man is your connection to spiritual living because you've been born again, created in righteousness and true holiness. These characteristics are divine in nature. Only God is righteous and holy. Your new man is perfectly right with God. Think of that for just a second. Your new man, the new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And your new man is perfectly right with God. It is God's seed planted in you. And his seed cannot sin. The new man is not the Holy Spirit. It is born of the Holy Spirit and is indwelt and empowered by the Holy Spirit. What satisfies God satisfies your new nature. This is the new you created in God's image. The reason you loathe the sin you still commit is because sin clashes with your new nature. We have within us an old nature, the old man, that's still here, crucified with Christ and yet still around. That influence. We have the new nature. The new nature is what is attracted to all things godly. It's what breathes in that rest when we hear the truth from God's word. That's the new man, the new creation that's inside of each one of us. And we have a decision, again, to be just real practical about it, we have a decision every time we're faced with the choice to sin or not. Our old nature wants to go towards sin, but our new nature wants to please God, wants to do that which is right. Romans 7, verse 19 says, "For the good that I would, I do not, but the evil which I would not, that I do. Now if I do that I would not, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me." You've experienced that struggle, haven't you? Have you experienced that? Well, this is what I should do, and I'm not going to do it.
Seven.
This is what I shouldn't do. Yeah, and I really enjoy doing it. We all have that. And who wrote Romans? I know it says Ephesians up here. That's the wrong book. Romans. Who wrote Romans? Paul. Would you consider Paul a fairly spiritual man? A fairly mature believer, probably?
Yeah.
He wrote this. The good that I would, I don't do. The things that I shouldn't do, that's what I do. And we've all experienced that. But then he says in Romans 7, verse 22, "For I delight in the law of God after the inward man." That new nature that's within us delights to do that which is right. So you know, and I know, this battle that we have within us of the new nature and the old nature. On page 189, we read, "Through Christ's exchange, you become a new person. Your regenerated spirit, the new you, loves what God loves and hates what God hates." You believe that from Scripture? You believe that there's a new nature within you that's created according to all that God, created according to righteousness? The Bible says it. And so what do we do with Bible truths that we don't feel?
We forget them.
We forget them. What should we do with them? You're right. You're right, unfortunately. What should we do? Well, from Romans 6, we're supposed to reckon them. When I don't feel God's truth, I still declare it to be so. I still acknowledge the fact. So the fact is, I've been crucified with Christ, but I still feel alive. I have a new nature that wants to do what's right, but I still have an old nature that wants to do wrong. So I, in those times when I can't feel my faith, I reckon. I account it as fact. Likewise, reckon ye yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. We're no longer connected to, we're no longer bound to the old man. When Jesus died on the cross, according to Romans 6, I died with him. And when he rose from the dead, I rose with him. And so I'm no longer connected. I'm no longer bound to the old man. We no longer work for the tyrannical boss. We've used this illustration. You had a boss who was awful. And so you quit and you went to the new boss who actually adopted you into his family. And when the old boss calls you up and says, I need you in the shop at 5 tomorrow morning, you say, I don't work for you anymore. I'm not coming in. But the trouble is so often we do go back to work for our old boss. We fulfill the lust of the flesh, even though we have a new master. So, turn to Ephesians 2, and in just a moment we'll get there. We're going to look at two passages that detail what happened when the exchange took place. As you turn to Ephesians 2, I'm going to put Colossians 1 up on the screen for you. It says, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness, and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Now, if you look up here, there's an awful lot that we have in Christ. There's an awful lot that when we were justified, when we trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, we received all of these things. We were made partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. We received a new inheritance. He delivered us from the power of darkness. Remember, justification is being freed from sin's penalty. I'll never go to hell because I've trusted Jesus Christ. We've been delivered from that. We're delivered from the power of darkness. We're translated into the kingdom of his dear Son. Again, I no longer serve the old tyrannical boss. When I trusted Christ, I got a new master. A new master who loves me, who gave his Son for me, and who adopts me into his family. I have redemption through his blood. I have the forgiveness of sins. All of these things are mine through Christ because of justification. Take a look at Ephesians 2. The reason I have you turn is because it's a little bit long to put on the screen. Ephesians 2, verse 1 says, and you hath he quickened. What does it mean to be quickened?
Made alive.
And you hath he made alive. You hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein, in time past, you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we had our conversation, or our lifestyle, in time past, in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. Verses 2 down through verse 3, that's describing what we used to be. I used to be on the wrong side. I used to be bound in the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh. Verse 4, those two words that start, Ephesians 2, 4, are wonderful. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, he's quickened us together with Christ. By grace are ye saved, and hath raised us up together, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. That is tremendous truth. When I trusted Jesus Christ at the time of justification, remember, I was placed into Christ. What is Christ's becomes mine. He took my sin and he gave me his righteousness. I was a child of the world. I was lost and undone, and I was born again. I was quickened, according to this passage, into the family of God.
Amen.
Take a look at question 6 on page 190. Did God give you new desires when he saved you? Well, if he gave new desires, maybe I could say this. We know that God didn't take away all of our old desires, right? So, but did he give us new desires? Yes. As a matter of fact, we from our memory verse, 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Wouldn't it be silly for God to make us a new creature and not give us new desires? Yeah. But he didn't. He made us a new creature, and he gave us new desires. And so now we old things are passed away, all things are become new. We have an ability, again, because we're not connected, we're not bound to the old man, we have the ability in Christ to do the right things because we've been born again. If any man is in Christ, he's a new creature. According to Ephesians 2, verse 6, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ. Again, tremendous truth. Where is Christ right now? He's at the right hand of God. And according to Scripture, positionally, I'm in Christ. So where am I right now? At least in a sense. I'm at the right hand of God. That's tremendous. Do you think you'll struggle with sin when you're at the right hand of God?
Nope.
When you're in God's presence, when you're in heaven, you think you're going to struggle with sin and temptation?
No,
you'll remember, glorification, you're delivered from sin's very presence. If we would reckon the truth of our position now, it would change the way we look at sin. I've used the illustration, if I was to handcuff myself, and I keep picking on Terry, if I was to handcuff myself to Terry, he wouldn't forget about it. But we forget about the one who's closer than handcuffs. We have living within us the Spirit of God. We've been placed into Christ. The Spirit of God is placed into us. We're sitting together with him in heavenly places, and yet we sin. And that doesn't make any sense. We shouldn't. We should be constantly aware of the presence of God. Take a look at page 193. Day 3. When you made the exchange with Jesus, you were born again. John 3, verse 3. Your new nature loves what God loves and hates what God hates, but your flesh is still the same as before you were saved. Ephesians was written to believers, and we read in Ephesians 4:22 that you put off, concerning the former conversation, the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lusts. Written to believers, because believers still struggle with deceitful lusts. Believers still struggle with these things. The flesh still pulls us back towards the old lifestyle and the habits out of which we were saved to begin with. We were delivered from those things, and yet we still have that pull back to them. James chapter 1, verse 14 says, but every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then, when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. On page 193, the author lays this out. He calls it the LSD principle. I'm not talking about the drug from the days have gone by, but lust, sin, and death. Lust. We're drawn away of our own lust and entice. We have within us that the Bible says in 1 John that all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, and we have within us that desire, and so Satan puts it up a temptation, and we lust after it. And lust, when it is conceived, it brings forth sin. On page 193, he says, this death that comes, we have lust that brings sin, and sin always brings death. There's no sin that God overlooks and says, well, no, that one's okay. They're all bringing about death. He says on page 193, this death is not the end of spiritual life, but the separation from its power. If you're living in sin, you've separated yourself from the power of God. We sing the song sometimes, nothing between my soul and the Savior. Well, when you sin, what are you doing? You're putting something between your soul and the Savior. You're blocking the power of God that He would have in your life. Isaiah 59 verse 2 says, but your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid His face from you that He will not hear. When you sin, when I sin, it separates me from the power of God that would work in me to do righteousness. Sin's a big deal. We all struggle with this, and again, the thing you struggle with may be a little bit different than the sin that I struggle with. But all of us have sins that easily beset us. They kind of come up on us. And again, you might look at the sins that get me and you'd say, well, how can you possibly struggle with that? That's no big deal. But I might look at the sins that you struggle with and say, how on earth can you have an issue with this? That's easy. But Satan knows exactly what to push into each of our lives, and we start to lust after it. And lust brings forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, brings forth death. Every single time, it brings forth death. That sin separates us from God. So how do we break that cycle of lust, sin, and death? When we find ourselves in it, it's real easy. Have you ever had this thought? You're going about your life, and you're experiencing a measure of victory, and you're happy, and you're praising the Lord, and then a temptation comes, and you see it coming, and you know, I shouldn't do it, and you see it, and it's kind of, you've got it in your peripheral vision a little bit, and you think about it, and it just kind of eats away, and eventually you say, this time's different, I can do it this time. So you sin, and now you're separated from the power of God, and once you get into sin, what's easy to happen?
Sin again.
You get into this cycle. It's like when you break a diet and you eat an Oreo, right? And you think, well, I might as well eat that sleeve now, right? I'm an American. I'm no quitter, right? I'm going to eat the whole now, and you just go at it, right? Sin's like that. It creates this cycle. Where you started out, you thought, I know this is coming, I shouldn't do this, and then you did it, and now you think, well, now I messed up. Now I've got to go confess this anyway, so I might as well do more and more and more. And you just start circling the drain until you find yourself in a place that you didn't think you'd be. And you're sitting there and you think, how in the world did I get here? Well, you got here because of that sin that you saw coming. You allowed the lust to bring forth sin. Sin brings forth death. And that sin has the tendency to multiply even within our lives. So how do we break it? How do we get out of that cycle of lust, sin, death, and then more sin, and more, and just further and further from God? How do we break it? We need the blood of Christ. Can you think of a verse, maybe in 1 John?
Seek first the kingdom of God and all of His righteousness.
Yeah?
These things will be added to you.
Absolutely. How about 1 John 1, 9?
Yeah.
Deals specifically with our sin. If we
confess.
So I'm down here in the pit of sin as a believer. I've compromised. I bought into the lies of Satan. I thought it would be different this time. I thought I could handle it. I thought it would only affect me. I thought this time I'm the exception to the rule, and now I'm sitting here in this dark, dark place. How do I get out of it? Well, it starts right here. If we confess. Okay, and we've used the word confess has the idea of to say the same word. Okay, to say the same thing. I'm not genuinely confessing my sin if I'm trying to minimize it. If I scratch somebody's car and I go to them and I say, I scratched your car, but I mean, it was kind of scratched anyway. Am I confessing? No, not genuinely. If I say, I scratched your car, but you'll never know it under all the dirt you let be on it. Am I confessing?
No.
No, I'm minimizing. I'm making what I did look as good as I can make it look. And that's the problem with sin. We come before God and we say, well, Lord, I'm sorry, but everybody was doing it. Well, Lord, I'm sorry, but you know how it is. You know how you made me. Right? Is that true? No, but we try to minimize it. If you're going to break the lust, sin, and death cycle that will just keep taking you further and further away, it requires confession, which is saying the same thing about it. Lord, forgive me. What I did is inexcusable. It's wrong. It's wicked. It's awful. Forgive me. When we come to the Lord with that right understanding, what will demonstrate a genuine change of mind about my sin? Confession. What will demonstrate most clearly that I've had a genuine change of mind? A change in behavior, right? A genuine change of mind will result in a change of behavior. If back to scratching the car, and I'm going to scratch Terry's car. Okay, I'm out here, Terry catches me, and I'm out there, and I'm keying his car, okay, and I say, Terry, I am so sorry about this. What's the problem?
I'm not sorry.
Why? Because I'm still keying the man's car, right? And yet we come to the Lord sometimes and we do this, don't we? We come to the Lord, we have no intention of actually making the difference of saying, look, I've been going this direction. Lord, this direction's wrong. Forgive me. And we go this direction. We have the idea where, Lord, forgive me, and we still kind of keep going this direction. That's not genuine repentance. That's not genuine confession. When I genuinely confess, I'm going to agree with God about how bad my sin is. And you can bet that if I'm agreeing with God, I'm going to stop what I'm doing. There will be a change of mind that results in a change of behavior. That's how we end this cycle. We come to the Lord in confession, which genuine confession includes repentance, to stop doing what you're doing, to hate your sin, and to turn to the Savior. And then, when we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins.
Amen.
Why? Well, because of His Son. Because Jesus died for those sins. Those sins they're under the blood. They can be forgiven. There's no sin that can't be forgiven of a believer if I will but humbly come and confess it. On page 194, he says, though sin affects your relationship with God, it does not change your legal standing with God. Real quick here, what does justified mean?
Just as if.
Just as if I never sinned. But remember the legal term? It means to declare
clean.
Declare righteous. Declare clean. Yeah? I've been justified. I've been declared righteous by the blood of Christ. And when I sin, my justification is not taken away from me. Right?
Right.
Why? Because I've been born again.
Amen.
And just like with my father, my earthly father, I can sin, I can do something that will make my father embarrassed of me. But I can't do something that will make me not the biological son of my father. And I can do things that will interrupt and destroy the fellowship that I have with my heavenly father. But I've been born again into the family of God, and there's nothing that I can do that's going to make me not a part of the family of God. What will happen is it makes my communication difficult. I destroy the fellowship. I can never make myself not the son of my father, but I can make dinner very, very awkward, right? When we sit down and there's all of this animosity in my family and we're not talking to each other because of some wrong that's been done, what needs to happen? Confession, forgiveness, repentance needs to happen. And then what? Well, then fellowship is restored. When the Bible says, when we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with him. Sin doesn't cause us to be kicked out of God's family, but it does destroy fellowship. This cycle that we read about in James 1 of lust, sin, and death leads to broken fellowship. That's what we need to guard against. We're gonna stop there because we're out of time here, but we'll come back and we'll pick up on page 194 next time, and we'll deal with some of the questions, and Lord willing, we will finish up this lesson next time. Take these thoughts, take the principles that we've gone again. The goal is to be very, very practical, because tomorrow you're going to face the temptation to sin. You don't have to. You don't have to. You can make the right decision. You can choose to walk in the Spirit. The Bible says, if we walk in the Spirit, we shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. That's a conscious choice that's made by you and me. You're not going to find that you accidentally stumble into walking in the Spirit. It is going to be a conscious choice. According to Ephesians, it's going to be you walking circumspectly. You making the decision. I'm going to do right now, and I'm going to do right now, and now, and just continually taking steps of right living and right choices. Let's bow for a word of prayer here this morning. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for your goodness and your love and your word and the promises that it contains to us. Lord, I pray that as we go about our business, that we would seek to live lives that are worthy of the great position that we've been given in Christ. I pray that we would walk in victory, that we would have the Spirit of God as our functional source rather than the resources of the flesh. I pray that you would receive honor and glory out of our lives. We thank you once again for the privilege that we have to gather together in your name today. I pray that we would meet with you, that we would worship you in spirit and in truth, as you've commanded us to. In Jesus' name, amen.